your father by when he's rested. Seems to me like 25 cents a week's enough for a boy your age. I declare, I don't know how you spend it all.
Oh, my, I got a lot of things to buy.
Strawberry phosphates, that's what you spend it on.
I don't see how Rebecca comes to have so much money. I mean, she has more than a dollar.
I've been saving up gradual.
Oh, dear, I think it's a good thing to spend some every now and then.
Ma, do you know what I love most about the world? Do you? Money.
Eat your breakfast.
In his own garden.
Oh, excuse me, Mr. Forrest.
You go out and play in the fields, young man. You got no business playing baseball on Main Street.
I'm awfully sorry, Miss Forrest. Hello, Emily.
Hello.
You made a fine speech in class.
Well, I was really ready to make a speech about the Monroe Doctrine. But at the last minute, Mrs. Corcoran made me talk about the Louisiana Purchase instead. I worked an awful long time on both of them.
Gee. You know, it's funny, Emily. From my window over there, I can just see your head at nights when you're doing homework over in your room.
Why can you?
You certainly do stick to it, Emily. I don't see how you could sit still that long. I guess you must like school?
I just figure it's something a person has to go through.
Yeah.
I don't mind it, really. It passes the time.
Well, Emily, what do you think? We might work out a kind of telegraph system from your window to mine. And every once in a while, you could give me a sort of hint or two about one of those algebra problems. No, look, I don't mean the answers, Emily, just a sort of hint.
Well, I think hints are allowed. So, George, if you get stuck, just whistle to me, and I'll give you some hints.
Well, thanks, Emily. You're just naturally bright, I guess.
I just figure it's the way a person's born.
Yeah, well, you see, I want to be a farmer. And my Uncle Luke says that whenever I'm ready, I can come over and start working on his farm. And if I'm any good, then I can just gradually have it.
You mean the house and everything?
Yeah. Well, I better be getting out to the baseball field, but thanks for the talk, Emily. Oh, good afternoon, Miss Webb.
Good afternoon, George.
So long, Emily.
So long, George.
Emily.
Hello.
Hello.
Isn't the moonlight terrible? I can't work at all.
Emily, did you get the third problem?
Which?
The third.
Well, yes. George, that's the easiest one of them all.
I don't see it. Could you give me a hint?
I'll tell you one thing. The answer's in yards.
What, in yards? What, how do you mean?
In square yards.
Oh, in square yards.
Yes. George, don't you see?
Yeah.
In square yards of wallpaper.
Oh, square yards of wallpaper. Thanks, Emily.
You're welcome. Isn't the moonlight awful? And choir practice going on. I bet if you hold your breath, you can hear the train all the way to going to Kuntinkook. Do you hear it?
What do you know?
Well, I guess I better head back and try to work.
Well, good night, Emily.
Good night, George.
Make yourself comfortable, George. I'll only keep you a minute. George, how old are you?
Well, I'm 16. Almost 17.
What do you want to do after school's over?
Well, you know, Pa. I want to be a farmer on Uncle Luke's farm.
You'll be willing, will you, to get up early and milk and feed the stock? And you'll be willing to hoe and hay all day?
Yeah, sure I will. How do you mean, Pa?
Well, George, while I was in my office this morning, I heard a funny sound. What do you think it was? It was your mother, chopping wood. Now there you see your mother, getting up early, washing our clothes, cooking our meals, and still she has to go out there and chop wood. I suppose she just got tired of asking you and figured it would be easier to do it herself. and you get up and you put on the clothes she keeps nice for you, and you go off and play baseball. Like she's some sort of hired maid that we keep around the house, but that we don't like very much. I knew all I had to do was call your attention to it. George, I've decided to raise your spending money, 25 cents a week. Not, of course, for chopping wood for your mother, because, well, that's the sort of present you give her. But because you're getting older, and I imagine there are lots of things that you must find to do with it.
Well, thanks, Pa.
Let's see. Tomorrow's payday. Suppose Rebecca will feel she ought to have some more, too. I wonder what's been keeping your mother this late. Choir practice has never run as late as this before.
It's only 8:30, Pa.
You know, I don't know why she's in an old choir anyway. She hasn't got any more voice than an old crow, and traipsing around at this hour of the night, it's just about time you retired, don't you think?
Yes, Pa. Now, get out, Rebecca. There's only room for one at this window.
Let me look just a minute.
I'll use your own window.
I did, but there's no moon there. George, do you know what I think? Do you? I think maybe the moon's getting nearer and nearer, and there'll be a big explosion.
Rebecca, you don't know anything. If the moon were getting nearer and nearer, well, then the men that sit up all night with the telescopes would see it first, and they'd tell us about it, and it would be in all the newspapers.
George, is the moon shining on South America, Canada, and half the whole world?
I don't know. It probably is.
Never told you about that letter Jane Crowfer got from her minister when she was sick. He wrote Jane a letter, and on the envelope, the address was like this. It said, Jane Crowfer, the Crowfer Farm, Grover's Corner, Sutton County, New Hampshire, United States of America.
What's funny about that?
But listen, it's not finished. The United States of America, the continent of North America, the Western Hemisphere, the Earth, the solar system, the universe, the mind of God. That's what it said on the envelope.
What do you know?
Yep, and the postman brought it just the same.
What do you know?